Why you should not let your bike idle to warm up. Now I know, this probably makes me sound like some heartless bastard with no mechanical sympathy whatsoever, but trust me, that couldn't be further from the truth. So before you call the bike protection services,
you'll never take me alive, copper,
and notify the engine welfare charities, I'd like you to hear me out on why I don't let my bike idle any more than the 10-15 seconds it takes me to put my gloves and helmet on, and why you probably should too. And we've all had that one friend, if it isn't you even, who insists on warming up the old girl. He starts his bike and then proceeds to chain smoke a pack of cigarettes.
15 minutes later.
15 minutes later of pissing off the neighbors and with only one lung left. Weight reduction, bro. He finally gets on the bike and takes off. Not pointing fingers here, I've been guilty of doing that myself. Although it was with boring Corona, so really who cares about those. Now, if you realize that you do this, before you start considering eBaying your bike, do not worry, you won't have ushered in the four horsemen of the bottom end apocalypse. Nor will the bike one day just suddenly self-combust, unless it starts with D and ends with Ducati, but that's for other reasons. It will mostly be fine. But we're not about just what's okay or fine at Erstride. We're enthusiasts, we care about our bikes. We love our machines and want them to last for a long time. Which brings me nicely onto the first and probably biggest reason why I personally frown upon excessive idling. Fuel atomization. Now this is a vulgarization channel, so we won't get into Bible of Fuel Injection Volume 2, Psalm 59.
You read the Bible, Ringo?
But essentially, petrol is injected into cylinders to be ignited in very fine mist form. You can see it here in this GSXR at full throttle. And that's pretty much always been the case since carburetors. It allows it to mix better with the air, it cools down the cylinder so it prevents knock, and so on. The issue is when you start a cold engine on cold fuel, you don't have great atomization, so not enough of the fuel actually vaporizes for combustion. The bike's brain deals with it like younger me would deal with a hangover, with more alcohol. So the engine compensates by injecting more fuel into the cylinder so there are enough vapors for combustion. What you end up with is this air-fuel mixture so rich in fuel, the US considers invading it and giving your engine some freedom.
What? Who said something about, oh, bitch, you cooking?
And that's not without consequences. All that extra fuel that didn't vaporize also condenses on the cylinder walls. Fuel is a pretty damn good solvent. So the fuel washes away the very important film of oil that's on the walls. We're talking about 2 microns in thickness, but it is a crucial layer. And because cold oil is heavy, it might be a while before that film of oil comes back. So without that film, you can end up with piston rings that scrape against the wall with less lubrication rather than glide over the film of oil like usual, which can greatly shorten the lifespan of an engine. Now the point of all this, by simply riding off from a cold start, you're helping the engine warm up much quicker, and therefore minimize the length of time the engine is forced to dump fuel into the cylinders. But, and this is a Kardashian sized but, one should not ride like the checkered flag has just been dropped and you're setting a new home to office Grand Prix lap record. As a rule of thumb, I don't use more than a quarter of my available RPM, so if your bike idles from cold at 2000 RPM and your max RPM is 11,000, then I wouldn't exceed around 4,250. You want a nice, gentle, uniform rising temperature within your engine, which you can only get through gentle riding for at least 10 minutes or so. Think of it as foreplay, but with your bike. You wouldn't whip out the BDSM kit right away without at least a bit of hair stroking. If some of you are worried about lack of oil because it drained to the pan overnight, well, you'll be happy to know that oil pressure picks up within literally seconds in modern engines. As long as you're sticking to gentle riding, you do not need to idle for 10 minutes for the oil to reach the top or crevices. Even cold, modern oil literally comes from the magical realm compared to the old stuff, and leaves a fair amount of residue behind, so pickup of flow is very quick when you start from cold, unless it's minus 40 degrees outside, or it's a badly rebuilt engine's first startup, or the oil filter has been changed without being filled first, oil pressure picks up immediately. Fuel leak. Tolerances within your engine are not static and are bigger when the engine is cold, and then tighten up to a perfect seal once the engine gets up to operating temperature. Now I've seen engines stick up a bar to a bar and a half in compression just from being warmed up. Now as we know, piston rings when cold are never a perfect seal. They always have a gap, and that's to allow for expansion of the ring with heat. This is the exact same reason why railroads have gaps or expansion joints, because if you didn't have them, as soon as it gets hot, you'd end up with this spaghetti as your tracks. Back to rings. I meant piston rings. Now remember how the engine dumps more fuel at cold starts? Well, some of that fuel will get past the rings, and especially the ring gap, which can lead to fuel contaminating the oil. Just 5% fuel dilution can cause the oil to lose up to 25% in its viscosity. This means 10W40 oil may degrade to 5W30. So the oil loses its viscosity, its film strength, and with higher fuel concentration, you might as well put apple juice in your engine. Its fate to end up in a bin is sealed. See what I did there? Seals. Tolerances. No? This can be made worse if you only make short rise, because the engine oil won't reach a high enough temperature to vaporize the fuel within it. So this is another reason why you don't want to excessively idle your engine, because you're not bringing it up to temperature fast enough for those gaps to seal, for those tolerances to tighten, and for that sweet, sweet compression to give you all the power. Everything else. The danger of the warming up the old girl for excessive periods of time is that some people think that it is warmed up and therefore ready to be abused, but that's really not the case. The engine might be warm, but literally nothing else of the bike is warm. The suspension oil is cold, the tires are cold, the brakes and disc pads have no heat in them, chain grease or drive shaft oil could do with a bit of warmth in it, the catalytic converter is cold and that one really hates not having heat, and the list goes on. You might have a warm engine, but the rest of the bike is either stiff or slippery. Wait, I'm sure there's a very immature joke in there. No. Really? Oh, f*** off. Jesus Christ, what are you doing? Right. So to sum up, the kindest thing you can do to your bike is to start it, then simply gently ride it off. The engine and its oil, along with everything else, will be brought up to temperature faster, which will make for a happy, more powerful bike that's very likely to last much longer. Not to mention, you won't be wasting valuable time you could be spending slaving away in the office, or with your friends, whatever those things are, I wouldn't know. And you'll be keeping the neighbors happy if you got a loud bike. Naughty. For you heroes out there with carbureted bikes, well, you're the only ones who escape the rules, since carburetors act like fuel injection with one single static air fuel ratio, rendering bikes sometimes impossible to start without a choke or very lumpy to ride from cold. But don't think you watched all this way for nothing. Those fueling issues we talked about earlier apply to you too. See, when you use the choke to start a bike, you're essentially cutting the engine's air supply harder than that twisted German BDSM asphyxiation video you watched and wish you never did, which makes the air fuel ratio very rich in fuel, ergo all the excess fueling issues we discussed. So the best thing to do on a carby is to use the choke very, very sparingly. Ideally only to start up and then using the throttle as soon as possible to keep it alive and put some heat into it. So there you have it. And before you go, have I told you about this button? This is the subscribe button. And I think you should click on it. Here's 10 reasons why. Number 6 will amaze you. No, really, please subscribe. It allows me to make more videos which you guys seem to like. If you have any questions you'd like me to cover, let me know. I've had some great suggestions in the last video, so I'm building a list of topics to cover. This is your channel as much as it is mine. You know how it goes. Subscribe, like, share, and I'll see you on the next one. Girl looks... ow. Not to mention, you won't be wasting valuable time. You could be Stop saying wasting. Just 5% fluid...